me sing joy to the world.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
Lord Jesus, for your saving grace. Men of faith.
Men of faith, rise up and sing of the great and glorious King. You are strong when you are weak, and your brokenness complete.
So we shout to the north.
Shout to the north and the south. Sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all. He's the Lord of heaven and earth.
Rise up, women.
Rise up, women of the truth. Stand and sing to broken hearts. Who can know the healing power of our awesome King of love?
So we shout
truth on our lips.
Right. Rise up, church.
Rise up, church, with broken wings. Fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By His grace, again we'll fly.
Shout to your neighbor that he's the Lord of heaven and earth. All right, everyone, why don't we gather and find our seats this morning? It's a beautiful morning, isn't it, after all that rain? How many of you just enjoyed that? Yeah, right on. Good, I did. Thank you. Hey, as you get seated this morning and as we kind of carry on with our service, I want to just bring a couple of announcements to you. One, please do take a peek at that really neat flyer that my wife designed with the Christmas ornament there. It's really beautiful. Let's hear it for Rochelle. She's a very good designer of flyers. It would look perfect on your refrigerator. And anyways, the content is what's important. We have some changes over this Christmas season for a few of our service. And one thing that I wanted to highlight was that next Sunday is going to be a special family service. And our kids will be in. Our children will be singing. And also the Zion Yuletide Carolers, if you have ever heard of them. Yeah, they're pretty good. So they'll be blessing us with special Christmas music. And so you won't want to miss that. So that's next week. And let your friends and neighbors know about that. And then our Christmas Eve candlelight service is a really special tradition. And so we'll be meeting Christmas Eve at 5 p.m. for that service. And it is a one-hour service, as it says there in parentheses. We are really good about that. We don't go over because we know that there's things for you all to go to with family afterwards and so forth. So really encourage you to be a part of that. And then also note that our midweek services, the 23rd, our Wednesday service, and the 30th are going to be canceled so that you can all spend time with family and enjoy one another. And the busyness of all this hustle and bustle, it's important to just kind of slow down and to be with each other and then to regroup and to go big in January, right? All right, good. Hey, before, yeah, thank you for all four of you guys that were on with me. Listen, I wanted to really encourage and affirm Millie for an amazing Christmas production. Millie, they said it couldn't be done. 21 kids on stage, and you did it, and we weren't surprised a bit. If anyone could do it, we know you could. But it was awesome just to hear the gospel preached to the young people, and the kids were wonderful. The choir was awesome, and no broken legs or anything like that. Everybody managed to do well, and it was an awesome time. So I really do want to thank you for all the hard work that you put in, and as well all the rest of your team that worked hard with you to make that happen. So thank you, Millie. Let's give her another big round of applause. Scott, did you want to say something? You can. Oh, okay. Millie wanted me to tell you that next week you can sign up today, and John Cush from Channel 7, if you're there. No. John filmed that production, and so they will be available on DVD, and it's also on the internet if you want to check out that production if you weren't here for it. So next week, available on DVD, sign up today if you want that, okay? Scott, would you come and receive the offering this morning?
As Yash was prepared to receive the offering, the other thing I thought was great, didn't you love Daniel up there when he did his song? And the posing, he was working it, wasn't he? It was good. It was great. He's going to be a star, absolutely. I just want to read a quick couple verses as the ushers come forward. I happened to read these the other day, and you know, it just stuck with me. And it's Psalm chapter 8, verses 3 through 6, and it says, "When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? You have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You've put all things under his feet." And when you take a look at that word honor, it means honor, glory, adornment, magnificent beauty. And it comes from the verb hadar, which is to glorify or to make splendid. And you think about the fact that God has ordained us as human beings with that. I mean, sometimes we have a different view of ourselves because we know ourselves better than everybody else knows us, right? But look at what it says about what God did for us, that he ordained us, right? That he ordained us with glory and honor. And that's amazing when you think about what that means. So just hold on to that this season as you think about it, as you celebrate the birth of Christ, and really understand what it is and who it is that we serve. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. God, we thank you that you love us so much, that Father, you have given us honor, and you have ordained us, Lord God, with glory and with just the splendor of who you are. Father, we are so thankful to you. We love you so much, Father. And we ask today that as we prepare to worship and as we prepare to give our offerings, Father, that God, that we would do it with a pure heart. And that, Lord, that you would give us, Lord Jesus, the desires to serve you. Give us the desire, Lord God, to give of everything that you've given us, Lord God, with a happy heart, Father. And as we do so, we ask that you would use those things, Father, to further your kingdom. But God, we also ask that you would put a touch in us this season to be bold in your faith, Lord God, that as we stand in line at the store, as we stand in line at the mall, God, that as we see people standing there, that Lord, as we look at them, you would speak to us. We'd be able to touch the hearts of those that maybe need to hear from you. God, you're a good God. You care about each one of us. Bless this day, I pray. Bless Pastor Danny as he brings the word. Let it touch the hearts of each person in this room. Let us leave here changed forever. We thank you for it, Father, in your name. Amen.
sing Silent Night with us. His name, name above all names.
Name above all names. Worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great. come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ. We'll give you all the glory. We'll give
every care upon you, and we bring every need before you. Because you're the only one that can meet the need, God. You're all powerful. You know, just as we are here in worship, let's take a moment to intercede. And maybe some of you have heard or you follow on the prayer line or on Facebook or whatever, that Maggie's husband, John, had an episode with his heart, and he'll be going in for a triple bypass surgery. And so we just want to pray this morning for Maggie, who's our church secretary, and her husband, John. So let's take a moment. Maybe where you're at now, you could just pray on your own, and then agree with me in prayer as we join our hearts together. Lord, we just lift up prayer to you. Would you join the hand of the person that's next to you? You don't have to stretch across the aisles, but let's just pray in unity. Just join hands. And God, we lift up our concerns, our cares, and we choose to walk in a posture of humility before you. God, kneeling our hearts before you, recognizing that all glory belongs to you, all power is yours. And God, we bring our cares and concerns. And Lord, we're concerned about the sicknesses that run throughout our church. And this season, this time, it seems like so many are ill. God, we lift that before you. We pray for a healing touch upon every person, Lord, their family members, or members of our community, those that are in the hospitals. God, would you just bring healing, Lord, to these various infections and flus and whatever else it is. God, bring healing, we pray, in the name of Jesus. God, we stand in the gap for those that know you in the city and those that don't. God, we want to see your hand of mercy come upon them, and we want healing to come to our area, and we ask for it in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we pray specifically this morning for John Carter, and we ask that, God, you would give him peace, Lord. You would guard his heart and his mind with your perfect peace, Lord. And as they operate on Tuesday, that it would be a smooth operation, and that, God, that all the best case scenarios would be in play, Lord, and that this clogged artery and the few clogged arteries would be released, and God, he would just have a whole new lease on life. And so we bless him, we bless Maggie and their entire family this morning. In the name of Jesus, thank you, God. Let's just sing one more song together, and as we do, I invite you to just cast your cares upon the Lord and the cares of your family members, and just believe that God can meet every need. Find our hearts yielded to you this morning. God, we choose that. God, we bless your name. And Lord, we lift up the name of Jesus above all things. As we sung that song, how great is our God, the name above all names. Lord, we don't just say it as words, but we declare it into the atmosphere that you are the King of Kings and that you are the Lord of Lords. You are Jesus. You're Jesus. And we worship you. And we praise your holy name. In fact, would you do this? Would you just declare the name of Jesus? I know you're sitting. You can stand if you want it. You can sit. But would you declare his name? And could we just applaud the presence of the Lord? Let's just thank God. Just speak out the name of Jesus. We worship you. Praise you, God. Praise your name above all names. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. I want to thank our worship team for leading us in just such an awesome time. And I don't know if you noticed, Greg had the week off, and so my nephew Cole's back here playing the drums. I thought he did a great job. So As we're getting settled in this morning, a couple of things to keep in mind. Be praying for Ryan Valle. You know Ryan, he's one of our youth. And Ryan took off on Friday to Fiji. And he's there as a part of an outreach with Youth of the Mission and super excited and on fire for the things of God. God's really just sparked something awesome in him. And so he's excited to go and share what he's learned with the people there in Fiji. So keep Ryan in your prayers. And also wanted to read an email that came in last Sunday. You know, many of you have seen and had opportunity to use the live service when you're sick or whatever else. And so on the internet, you know that we're showing these services. So from time to time, we'll get emails from different people. And this last Sunday, we got an email from Kristen Damron, or her married name is Schroeder, and she's the granddaughter of Roy and Nancy Hendricks. And so many of you saw Kristen grow up here, and she may even be listening now, I don't know. But Kristen is in the Army, and so she just shared this. And so let me read it for you, and hopefully you'll be encouraged as well, and we can take a moment to pray for Kristen. It says, "Hello, I wanted to thank you for giving me the opportunity to listen and watch the sermons on the internet. I have not been able to find a church that I feel at home with here in Colorado Springs. I can't wait to come home for leave before I deploy for Iraq this coming March so that I can go to the church that I grew up in and have loved for so many years. It's so wonderful to hear and see the faces of the crowd at Zion. So thanks to you and everyone who made the video online happen. And I'm able to get the food that I need." And need is in all caps. It says, "to get me through the tough weeks. The next few months are going to be quite a challenge, knowing that I will be leaving the safe United States and going somewhere that is not so safe and secure. Only God knows what the future holds, and I leave it in his hands. So thanks for the not-so-good things in my life, as you stated in your words in this morning," speaking of last week. "I will fill out a prayer request for my family and friends at back home to stay strong and to leave in God's hands all things as well. So thank you, and I hope that the family is doing well." It says, "I'll see you all again soon. I'll be home December 19th, so she'll be here next Sunday, and I count on seeing me in one of those pews. Thanks again, and God bless." So this morning, you know, I thought it'd be great. We're going to pray for Kristen next week and just lay hands on her. And here's a young woman who signed up for the military and knowing what the cost would be. And she'll be deploying for Iraq. So if she's listening, Kristen, if you're listening, we just want to pray a blessing over you this morning. I also often think about the Bramers who are in Chicago. And I call that our Chicago branch of Zion. So their large family gathers together on Sundays and listens as well. So can we just take a moment and bless them, pray for them, and whoever else is listening out in cyberspace, which you're welcome to be part of us this morning. God, we just thank you, Lord, for technology, and we thank you for the things that are happening as a result of folks' faithfulness to serve you. We thank you. I do thank you for John and all the work that he's put in to make this thing happen. And this morning, Lord, we pray blessing over Kristen as she listens online and over the Bramers, God, and those that can't be with us this morning. Lord, let your spirit link us together in such a powerful way. Lord, let unity come. And we honor you, we praise you, and we worship you, and we glorify you, God. You're an awesome God, and you're doing awesome things in these days. And we love you in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Would you turn in your Bibles to the book of Luke in chapter 1? And this morning, I want to begin to turn our focus towards the greatest story of all. It's full swing Christmas. You're going to blink twice and it's going to be summer. Time is moving fast. It's just the way that it is. And you don't want it to move so fast that you miss out on the significance of these seasons. And the wonder of being a Christian is that Jesus is our gift all year long, that he's the risen Savior, not only on Easter, but all year long. You know, all these things are true all the time. But I thank God for these points along the way where we can sort of pause and reflect and think on the significance of what it means for something like Christmas or the birth of Jesus. And Luke chapter 1 begins to unfold the story. So these next couple of weeks, we're going to be looking more at the story of Jesus coming to earth. But today we're going to focus in on a couple of people that we talk about from time to time, but not so much as during the Christmas season. And that's Zechariah and Elizabeth. And I don't know how much you know about these two, but it might just be that their lives are a lot more like yours. And as you read through the scripture, it's sometimes we can read through it the eyes of thinking that these people were superheroes. You know, we read through it through the eyes of thinking that,
you know, these folks couldn't relate to us, but they must have sort of floated through life or, you know, kind of levitated through and just were different than everybody else. But these were everyday people who were going through everyday struggles and trials. And certainly Zechariah and Elizabeth were going through everyday big tests and trials in their life. How many of you are going through something right now in your life? Just raise your hand. There's something right on. You know, I ask that question pretty regularly. And some of you lie every time I ask that question. So I just want to call that out. We're all going through something. And like I like to say, if you're not going through something now, buckle up. Something's coming. And it doesn't mean that God is mean. It just means that this is a part of life. That God uses situations. He uses difficulties. He uses stuff to get us closer to Him. And that we have a unique opportunity in the midst of things that are difficult. We have a unique opportunity to worship God in the midst of those things. And that's exactly what we see modeled in these two. So let's turn. We're there. We're in Luke chapter 1. As I read through this large portion of Scripture, I'm going to read about 25 verses or so, or 20 verses. And I want you to kind of listen and engage as the text is being read. You might see it on the screen or you might have it in your Bibles. But look for some of these principles because they're throughout this story. And if you'll turn your mind on, and if you'll resist every temptation to turn your mind off, I think that God has something special for you. And so here's the principles I want you to keep your eyes looking for. The faithfulness to do the daily tasks that are set before you. You're going to see Zechariah as someone who just did the work. He showed up. Another principle is trusting in the timing and the direction and power of God. The timing, the direction, the power of God to orchestrate your life. You know that God is an amazing director. That He is orchestrating this part of the symphony and that part, and it all seems like chaos, you know? But somehow, in this moment, He's able to bring it all together in something so beautiful. I started to do this, and I was a little feeble about it. You know, this is kind of, anyways, never mind. But that's what He's doing, right? He's telling this person to do that and this person to do that and bringing this thing in. But see, God is so awesome that He's not just using people. He's using situations, circumstance, all kinds of things. All of it belongs to Him. And He's orchestrating something very beautiful in all of our lives, just as you'll see in this story. The third principle to keep in mind as I read it is the faithfulness of God to give us a time out when we need it. You know what a time out is? Time out, you get sat down for a little bit, right? I share a lot of stories about my kids. We give time outs often when our children don't do something that they're supposed to do or they show disrespect or whatever else. It gives them a time to sort of think about the things that are going on and how they could act differently. My son, by the way, told me this morning, he said, "Dad, you're a genius." And I said, "Thank you, son." So I just wanted to share that with you. Free. It was totally out of context, by the way. Totally out of context. I don't think he has any idea what genius means, but I took it as a compliment. The next principle is the comfort in knowing that He is your spokesperson and He is your advocate and your redeemer, that God is on your side. God is your spokesperson, and you're going to see some of that as we read through. So keep in mind those principles and listen with your hearts. This is Luke chapter 1, starting in verse 5. In the time of King Herod, the king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God, observing all of the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. Verse 7 says, "But they had no children because Elizabeth was barren. They were both well along in years. And once when Zechariah's division was on duty, he was serving as priest before the Lord, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and to burn incense. And the time for burning incense came, and all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. And then the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right hand or the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. And you would be too if you saw an angel." And verse 13 says, "But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you are to give him the name John. And he will be a joy and a delight to you. And many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth.'" Verse 16 says, "Many of the people of Israel he will bring back to the Lord, their God, and he will go before the Lord in spirit and in the power of Elijah, and he will turn the hearts of the father to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." He was not only an old man, but he was a wise man. He didn't say, I'm an old man, and my wife's an old lady. He said, she's well along in years. I thought I would just point that out to you. Verse 19, the angel answered, "I am Gabriel, and I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell the others and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not be able to speak until the day that this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time." And meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he had stayed so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but he was unable to speak. And when the time of the service was completed, he returned home. And after this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. In verse 25, "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days, he has shown his favor and has taken away disgrace from his people." Amen. If you're looking for a title for the service or for the sermon today, it'll be "These Days." And I have "these days, dot, 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 those days." How many of you know that you've got those days and these days? Some of us want to really forget about those days. And the truth of the matter is, some of us are living right in the middle of those days. Those days, what I refer to or talk about, the stuff of life that's pretty difficult. And pretty much what we like to say is things aren't happening like they should happen. You know, and it's difficult. It's difficult to cope with. It's difficult to deal with. It's difficult to understand and to try to even begin to answer the why question. But as we begin to just go kind of verse by verse here or chunk of scripture by chunk of scripture, we look at first at Zechariah and who he was. And so let's take a minute and kind of understand that principle of faithfulness and that of just showing up and doing what it is that God's called you to do. In verse 5, it says again, "In the time of Herod, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah." Zechariah clearly was a priest. It was his job. It was his vocation. It's what he did. And there were so many priests in this whole land of Israel that they were broken up into divisions because there were different places where people needed priests. And so not every priest got to minister in Jerusalem, which would have been the center for all religiousness or worship. That's where the temple was. But there were other priests like Zechariah, and he was in another region. And so among this division of priests, there were a bunch of priests, right? And time to time, they were called into Jerusalem to minister in the temple. And so it was a big deal. It was a big deal that it was sort of their turn. And in this particular season, it was Zechariah's turn. And when he showed up to do whatever was his job to do at the time. But there was a special job, and the special job was to minister before the Lord at the altar of incense. And so, but you read about these two, that they weren't just any priests. I look at Zechariah, he was kind of like the working man's priest, you know? He was doing the stuff. And so he not only had his sort of righteous lineage as a priest, but he also married a woman called Elizabeth. And what does it say about Elizabeth? You could look in your Bible. It says Elizabeth was also from where? Aaron, right? And what do we know about Aaron? What we know about Aaron is that Aaron is the priestly line. So he had he kind of had all the right stock there, you know? He himself was a priest. And a priest was not required to marry a woman from the priestly line. But when he did, it was very commendable. So when people would look at him, they would say, this is a righteous dude. He not only is doing the work, but he married a righteous woman. And then it speaks something highly of the two of them. It says that she was a descendant. But what does it say in verse 6? That both of them, not just Zechariah, both of them were what? They were upright in the sight of God. And then it goes on, and it says that they were observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. Let's just stop there, because the distinction that was given in the New Testament now was the same type of distinction that would have been given to guys like Noah, Moses, Abraham. It's a big deal. The original readers reading this in Luke, from Jewish lenses, they're reading this going, wow, Zechariah is the man. Seriously, I mean, he wasn't perfect. They would understand that he wasn't a perfect human being, but what he was righteous because he was fulfilling the requirements of the law. He was doing it right. And not only was he doing everything right, he didn't have an unruly wife who was kind of doing something else on the side. She was doing everything right too. They were doing the stuff. And some of you are sitting in this room right now, and you're doing things right. You're not perfect. I'm not perfect. None of us will be until we get to be with the Lord. But we're doing stuff right. We're doing our best to seek him, to find him, to walk with him, to serve him. When he speaks something to our hearts or shows us something in Scripture, we want to obey him. And you need to be encouraged in that. But you see, here's this next verse in verse 7, that as they're doing everything right, and not only right in God's eyes, but everybody else kind of recognizes it and sees it. Now here comes the elephant in the room. Verse 7 says this, but they had no children because Elizabeth was barren and they were both well along in years. For us, we read that and think, oh, what a bummer. For the original reader and for the people of their day, that was devastation. That was absolute devastation. That was confusion. Do you realize that even among the traditions of these people that it would be grounds for divorce? That a husband could say, well, my wife is not, having children was so important. That if she wasn't having children, that she could be divorced. And many men who love their wives, especially righteous men, they would procrastinate. And they would maybe be hearing, oh, you need to find a woman who can give you children. I mean, think about it. Think about what's going on in this righteous woman's life. Think about the pieces of Elizabeth's life that are just breaking, all of her heart that's breaking. And then they got to deal with people who want to help, but in their wanting to help, they make wacky suggestions. Go find a new wife. Find someone who can give you children so you can keep the line going. But you got a righteous man, Zachariah, and what does he do? A righteous thing in this case. He procrastinates. He says, oy vey, I'm not going to listen to you right now. Whatever he says, I don't know. But he put up with a lot of stuff for a lot of years throughout those childbearing years. And now they're at their point of old age. And at the point of old age, this wasn't the only time that this happened in Scripture, right? You know that from women in the Bible like Rachel. But at the point of old age, people kind of leave you alone because they, well, you know, we couldn't get through to Zachariah, so I guess they're going to just sort of live on. But see, the important part for the reader as they were reading this is there would be kind of a conflict in their thinking. They'd be thinking, wait a minute, this doesn't make a whole lot of sense because within their grid of thinking, a barren woman would have been somehow disciplined by the Lord. A barren woman would have been someone who didn't have the blessing of God. How does that all work together? Do you follow me? There was a precedence. We can't be too hard on these people. There was a precedence as well. There was a precedence in that, you remember when Michael judged David, when he started kind of dancing in his underwear before the Lord, just was like, woohoo, and his linen ephod and was all free. And she kind of got sarcastic with him. And what happened to her? That she received the discipline of the Lord and it resulted in barrenness. And so there was a context for this. Yeah, right on. Whose phone? Come on, admit it. I'm kidding. I promised to never do that again, and I broke my own promise because that happened to me in the worst possible place, and I won't even tell the story where my phone went off. It was horrible. All right, but anyways, I apologize for any ounce of embarrassment I just caused to the person whose cell phone just went off. Okay. Back to the point is this. You might not relate to barrenness. You might relate to it, talking in specifics. You might not relate to that, especially some of the men, or you might. But all of us relate to something of a sense of barrenness in our own life, a sense of, God, why, if I'm doing all the right stuff, is not all the right things happening? Do you follow me? Why, God, if I'm serving you and pursuing you? In fact, I had a neighbor, and he was telling me, he said, man, it wasn't until I started pursuing God with all my heart that my whole world fell apart, that I lost my house, that I lost this, and then all this stuff happened. And I just kind of scratched my head, and I stepped back from him, and I went to the wisest person I know, my wife, and I said, you know what our neighbor just said was this, and she said, well, you know, imagine if he didn't have God with him right now, you know, because that was coming. In other words, there was a lot that went on in this person's scenario that led to the point that that consequence came. Right? And thank God that he had God to turn towards. And so, but this wasn't the case for these two. They were doing stuff right. And so we got to try to understand, well, what's happening? We read on and let's get there in verse 8, if you can get there in your Bibles in verse 8. Let me say this as you're turning there because I brought up a big question. If this wasn't the punishment of God, If this wasn't his judgment, then what was it? And you know what? It was an opportunity. Certainly, it was an opportunity for Elizabeth and Zechariah to be faithful and to worship God when it hurt. To worship God in probably the one of the most sweetest opportunities. To be able to worship God in the midst of brokenness and confusion, it's got to be the most pure and honest worship. Do you follow what I'm saying? How do we know in our own lives? Because people often ask me that question. Am I being punished right now? You know, all this is happening in my life. Is God mad at me? And I want to tell you this, that if you're going through a bunch of stuff in your life and God is disciplining you, then you know it. You will know it. Why will you know it? Because if we look through the model of Scripture, God in his mercy definitely disciplines. He does. It tells us that in the Old Testament and the New Testament. But guess what? When he disciplines, he makes it so incredibly clear. He warns you. He warns you again. He warns you through his word. He warns you through people. He woos you. He draws you in, right? And when nothing seems to work, he loves you so much that he begins to discipline you. And then within your discipline, in that time of discipline, he wears you down to the point where you're able to fall on your knees and say, oh God, I'm a mess. Would you come and put me back together? And he says, yep, exactly. That's what I was waiting for, and I will definitely do it. And so if you're in the midst of God's discipline, it's because he loves you. The Bible makes it very clear in Hebrews that he disciplines those that are his children. And so if you don't know what's going on and it doesn't seem to make sense, you're probably not under discipline. But you're probably given an opportunity to worship God in the most honest way that you'll ever be able to worship him. And that's, I think, where Elizabeth was at. Let's look at verse 8. And let's see just how God is in the details. In Luke 1:8, it says, when Zechariah's division was on duty, he was serving as a priest before the Lord. And he was chosen by lot, as was the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple and to burn incense to the Lord. This was when the priest would go in, and he would take the coals off the altar, and he'd put them in a golden bowl. And then he would put on those coals, he would sprinkle incense. And as the incense hit the heat of the coals, it would produce smoke, which would ascend and rise to heaven. You read about it in Revelation, I think it's chapter 8, that the incense would come before the throne of God. And it was a picture of something really beautiful that was happening. As that was sprinkled, a smoke would rise. The priest would begin to intercede for the people. He would pray, and he would make intercession. We did that a little bit this morning. It's a beautiful thing to be involved in intercession. Intercession is standing in the gap for somebody else. It's right that you pray for your needs. It's right that you pray for the things that God is doing and you commune with God. But it is so right to wait before the Lord and to serve others in prayer, to just take that time and say, God, would you meet the need of this person or that person? And they may never know you do it. They may never know what you pray. But rest assured, you're making a difference in their life, that the very prayers that you're praying are shifting things on earth and in heaven, enabling something wonderful to happen. And so that's what was happening. And they got like a picture of it. Incense was rising. Zechariah, let me rewind for a minute, that they cast the lots in order for him to go in and do that. That's because there were so many priests, and this was such a huge honor. It wasn't the kind of thing that within his division, in their two-week stint, because they would take 2 weeks over in Jerusalem to do their duties, it wasn't like they'd sit together and go, oh, you want to do the incense? No, you do it, man. No, you do it. It wasn't that at all. It was, hey, we all want this. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. It was huge. So let's cast lots. And casting lots was like kind of like rolling the dice, and it was the way that they would seek the wisdom of God. But I want to tell you something, that God isn't a God of chance and accident, that God is in the casting of the lots in this scenario. And we know it from Scripture as well. And apply this part to your life, that the details of your life, God is in. That it didn't just so happen that this thing occurred to make this thing occur. God is involved in it. He's using situations and scenarios. Remember that picture of him being an orchestrator or one who is a director. He's making some kind of awesome symphony. If you'll be willing to worship him in the midst of the confusion, in the midst of the hurt, in the midst of the difficulty, he's doing something. And so as the smoke, or let me read this proverb because I think it makes good sense. Proverbs 16:33, it says, the lot is cast into the lap, but what? Every decision is from the Lord. You could have cast lots all day long, but the decision came from the Lord. God wanted Zechariah in Jerusalem when he wanted him there. He wanted Zechariah before his throne when he wanted him there. He wanted him to be the one that it was his once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to sprinkle water on the altar of and the incense to rise so that he might make intercession. God wanted it to happen, and guess what? It happened. Why? Because God is sovereign. Man, would you take peace in that? Would you just Take a moment and just let that soak in, that God is in control and he's powerful and he's sovereign. He's allowing situations to occur for his glory. And the response for us in the midst of all of it, whether we get it or we don't get it, is, I rest in you, God. I worship you. I worship you. And so as the incense rises, I just wonder, scripture doesn't say it, but it kind of, there's an indication there. I wonder as he's making intercession, if the first prayer that he prays is, God, would you please just do something for my wife? Would you do something for her? I mean, she's barren, Lord. I'm not saying he said it. You don't quote me on this. Don't make a webpage about it. I'm just saying I wonder. Because this is what happens right after. The angel of the Lord says to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah. Verse 11. Verse 10. At the time of the burning of the incense, he assembled the worshippers were praying outside, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was startled and he was gripped with fear. I wonder if he prayed the prayer and thought, oh no, I blew it. Because guess what? When the priest would go into that place, everybody was praying outside, and part of their prayers is, Lord, don't kill my priest. Right? Because it was such a holy place. And then an angel shows up in all the angel's glory just standing there. And he's gripped with fear. And as he's gripped with fear, the first thing the angel says is, don't be afraid. I got a message for you. And what is the message that he has? Don't be startled or gripped with fear. But the angel says, do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. This is verse 13. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you will give him the name John. And he will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. And then he goes on to give the details about how this boy is to be raised. God interrupts, and God comes with a message. And you see, in that situation of God's orchestration, Zechariah, he doesn't quite know how to take it. Again, he's probably overwhelmed with emotions, thinking he sees the angel, I'm a dead man, realizes he's not a dead man, processing through it all and saying, what do I do now? And how do I know this is true? And what does God do in his grace and in his mercy as he brings discipline to Zechariah in that moment? He says, Zechariah, you're not hearing me. And I know that I'm not going to get through. So what I'm going to do is put you on a timeout. And when he puts him on a timeout, it's interesting the type of discipline that he gets. He shuts his mouth. Let me ask you a question. When you don't talk, do you hear better? I can remember, you know, really trying to, I think I was about 19 years old, and I was on a mission trip and sitting there and wanting to hear God desperately, needing his direction. And I remember just sitting there, Lord, please talk to me. Lord, please speak to me. God, I want to hear your voice. Lord, I know you have something to say. And I was reading, God, you're not saying anything, and I just need to hear from you. And Lord, would you please talk to me? God, I'm desperate. And Lord, and I would get up and walk away. I would sit at the same bench, you know, and I would pray it and pray it. And I remember the revelation that came to me is, be quiet. Just be quiet. When you stop talking, you can hear a lot better. In fact, there's kind of science for it, isn't it? When you lose one of your senses, don't the other ones get better? Interesting, huh? God in his discipline silences him so that his ability to hear might be just a little bit better. Rest in that. Just rest in it. That's the love of a good dad. That's the love of a heavenly father. And he might be doing that. He might be silencing some of us for a moment in his grace and mercy, just sort of shutting our lips. Shutting our lips so that we might be able to hear just what it is that he's saying. Verse 24, I'm going to skip a portion. The portion is basically the consequence that's handed down. I just said what it was. But this is kind of the crux of it all. God comes through with justice, and he redeems, and he hears, and he acts. That God is your advocate. That God is your defender. That God is the one who knows the secret thing of your heart. That in the midst of a confusing situation where they had every opportunity to complain, where they had every opportunity to bail on God, where they had every opportunity to fall into disillusionment, what they chose to do was to be righteous and blameless before God. And again, that has got to be the purest, sweetest form of worship. It's the form of worship that says, I don't get what's going on, but I get you, and I rest in that, and I believe. And that might just be a word for somebody here this morning. You might not understand all that's going on, but what you understand is that God is good and that he's faithful and that you're going to rest in that. And you see, God is also a rewarder, because in verse 24, after it says his wife Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. I wonder what those 5 months were like for this woman who had years and years of putting together gifts for other women who are having babies. And this woman who for years overheard other people saying, get another wife, she can't get pregnant, there's something wrong with her. This woman for years who had just broken pieces in her heart, just broken. And again, as I said before, you might relate to that idea of physical barrenness, but all of us relate to something in our life that is just an issue of our life, a frustration, a concern, a confusion, or whatever it is. What is this part of my life all about? But this woman for years, and now here she is for 5 months watching her belly grow in seclusion. Wonder what she's thinking, you know? Golly. And then in the end of the time, it's pretty clear now that she's pregnant, like that story I told you a couple weeks ago when I asked somebody if they were with child and they were not, but that was at a different part of my life. It was clear. It was clear to all. It was clear to her. She was with child. And there was joy in it, because here's what she says. Do not be afraid, wrong verse, 24. She became pregnant for 5 months and she remained in seclusion. The Lord has done this for me. And she said, in these days, he has shown his favor and he has taken away my disgrace from among the people. You know, the gift of God is so multifaceted. He's doing so much at once. God is preparing the world for Jesus. He's preparing the world for the Son of God to come on the scene. And God, in his amazing ability to orchestrate, is taking the hurts and the wounding of this beautiful, awesome woman of God who's blameless before God. And he's granting the desire of her heart, and he's redeeming her. And he's doing it in such a public way that all the people get to see, hey, there is nothing wrong with Elizabeth. There's never been anything wrong with Elizabeth. And on some levels, for us, there's nothing wrong. I'm not saying that regarding our sin or our choices. I'm saying in the eyes of God, within the righteousness of God, that we're his children. And you see, so publicly now, everybody gets to see Elizabeth's pregnant. And her declaration is, God has removed my shame. But see, there was so much more, because this other part of the tapestry, there's this little girl, really a little girl, a teenager, who's about to meet an angel. And it's going to freak her out. Because this angel of the Lord's going to come to her and say, you're going to be with child, even though you're a virgin. You're going to be with child, and you're going to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit. And guess what? Your aunt, Elizabeth, she's also with child, and she's going to give birth. You see, Mary was going to need something to hang on to. And it was part of God's deal where he was doing something over here. He was doing something for Elizabeth, but he was also doing something for Mary, and he was doing something for us. He was doing something for you. Could it be that John's role, you know, the John the Baptist we're talking about now, and Elizabeth, this whole part of the story, we know that John's role was a herald, right? He was proclaiming the way of the Lord. He was saying, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He was the spotlight to begin to prepare the way for Jesus, right? And could it be that he was paving the way for us to understand that these are new days, that in these days, we're going to get to understand the Redeemer like never before. In these days, God is going to take the barrenness of our life and make it into fruitfulness. And he's going to do something tremendous. And it might help us to understand a prophecy that came in Isaiah in chapter 54. It was certainly a prophecy for the children of Israel, but I want you to hear it as a prophecy for you. Because I think there's an application here. Let's turn there, Isaiah chapter 54. Christmas, as we remember it from past history, and as we live in it today, is about the shaking of the whole world. It's about a change in the entire direction of mankind. It's Jesus coming on the scene. It's Jesus our Redeemer. It's Jesus our Savior. It's the one who didn't come to atone just in a one-time or in a periodic cause of events, meaning a priest who would just give sacrifices, but it was a perfect lamb who came to take away the sins of the world once and for all. It was shifting. Something was different about this Jesus. The people of Israel, in their perspective, couldn't really quite grasp it or understand it all the way, but there were little hints along the way. And this hint came in Isaiah chapter 54 when it says, sing, O barren woman, you who never bore a child. Burst into song, shout for joy, you who were never in labor. Because more are the children of the desolate woman than of her who has a husband, says the Lord. Verse 2 says, enlarge the place of your tent. Stretch the curtains wide. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen your stakes. For you will spread out to the right and to the left. Then your descendants will dispossess nations and settle in their desolate cities. Do not be afraid. You will not suffer shame. Do not fear disgrace. You will not be humiliated. You will never forget the shame of your youth. And remember, you will forget the shame of your youth. And remember no more the reproach of your widowhood. For your maker is your husband, the Lord Almighty is his name, the Holy One of Israel, your Redeemer, and he is called the God of all the earth. Catch a glimpse now on a bigger scale what this passage is saying. It's saying, hey, woman who couldn't have a baby and is speaking figuratively of an entire group of barren people, people who could not produce any light spiritually but were so given over to the flesh. You who can't produce, here's what you do. Woo, shout it out, rejoice. In fact, go and make a tent larger. Why do you make your tent larger? For more kids. That was the whole point. You know, the nomads didn't just have bigger areas of more square footage for entertaining folks. You know, it wasn't our context at all. They had to pack that stuff up and move it from place to place. The only reason you're going to want a bigger tent is for more kids. And more kids meant more workers, right? More people to feed the animals and to tend the sheep and so forth. And what the Spirit of God is saying is, even though it looks completely desolate, even though you're barren, even though that it's impossible, with me, nothing is impossible. So go ahead and walk in the victory part of it. Go ahead and walk in the reality that it already is. And the way that you're going to do it is you're going to just make a big tent, right? And I guess what I'm trying to say to you is, in the middle of your desolation, in the middle of your barrenness, in the middle of what you're going through, it is a great opportunity to worship God. It's a great opportunity just to offer pure praise before God and say, I don't understand, I don't know that I ever will, but what I understand is that you're good. And not only to take it from worship into action and to say, now I'm going to live like you are who you say you are. I'm going to live like you are my Redeemer, and that you are going to cover my shame, and that you are going to do what only you can do. Does this make sense at all? This is what Christmas is all about. This is what Jesus is all about. He's a Redeemer. But you know what? We respond or we reject the Redeemer. We respond or we reject the gift. Even as Christians, it might sound silly to say it, but we respond by embracing all of who he is and saying that even when it doesn't feel like it, you are. You are. You are. And I enlarge my tent. If you go back to Jeremiah, we covered this a little on Wednesday night. I think it was chapter 32. Jeremiah was asked to purchase a field in the middle of a time when the nation was being taken over by the Babylonians. It was a really dumb time to buy land. Really dumb time, right? I gave the analogy, it was kind of like, and being in the midst of a foreclosure, and then you go to a relative and say, hey, buy my house, but don't give the money to the bank, give it to me. You know, get what I'm saying? The land was already belonging to somebody else, and so Jeremiah's cousin comes to him and says, hey, buy my land, dude. He didn't say, dude, but I just said that. Buy my land, Jeremiah. And God had already told him to do it. Why? Because God wanted to show the people something, that it wasn't always going to be desolation. It wasn't always going to be confusion. But he not only bought the land, he put the deed and he duplicated it and got witnesses and put it in clay jars. So they would understand that Jeremiah is serious. He really believes that there's going to come a day when he's going to redeem that land and own it, even though the Babylonians are going to have it for a while. God calls us to this because we need to understand he's doing something on a macro, is that the word? On the big scheme. Let me just close with some things and hopefully bring it to a place of application, because I'm giving you some big ideas, I know. And I'm even giving you some opportunities to go, yeah, it must be easy for you to say. None of us know the contents of all of our lives. It's true. You know, it is amazing that we can be a close-knit church and we can find things out that people are suffering through, that we can find things out that people are going through, question marks in their mind. No one knew, I bet you, nobody knew what was going on in Zachariah's or Elizabeth's mind. Why? Because they were upright and righteous before the Lord. No one knows completely what's going on in your life or mine. We're together in this. Why? Because we're all the same kind of broken people, all of us. All of us are the same kind of people who were needing to be rewired by God. And so as we come before him, we understand that we're linked, each one of us, that we're all a part of a greater story, and God is doing a greater thing. When we shared on Wednesday night, I just shared this picture that I had in my mind. And I'll share it again here because I think it's significant to the season. The picture was of our hearts just being kind of like a grid and being fragmented out and sort of pieces of brokenness kind of falling out, right? And the promise from God was that he as a redeemer and a restorer would take those pieces and put them back together. And that's what we read about in Scripture. And I just shared it. It wasn't like, whoa, this monumental thing. It just was something God laid on our heart. And we took the time to respond and we prayed for one another. And then Lisa came up afterwards and she said, you know, I felt like God gave me a poem. And he gave me a scripture. And she shared it after the service. And I felt like there was even the right timing in that because I think that God wants you to hear this today. And as you listen to this, realize that you're going to hear a scripture, but you're also going to hear a special message to you from God, that this is what the Lord says. And it came in the form of a poem. And so I'm going to read the poem. It's called Broken Pieces. And by the way, this wasn't one that she dug out from the past. It was as this word was spoken, she just began to write. And this is what came. Broken pieces. Trials, struggles, life, cares, hurts, obstacles, questions, snares. At times it feels like your heart is breaking into pieces. And as you give these things to me, I will restore like the stained glass that you see. The pieces of your broken heart will become my love's tapestry, and I will strengthen your walk. You'll stand firm in me. All this is a part of your calling. That's a picture of a mosaic. A picture of in and of itself would be just a bunch of pieces of glass. As it's put together by someone who really knows what they're doing, it becomes something of beauty. That is something you need to hear, each one of you. Whatever you're going through, whatever the issues of life are, be it grand in your eyes or small, or somebody thinks it's small and you think it's big, it doesn't matter. Whatever the thing is, it is an opportunity to do what Elizabeth did, to worship God, to just worship him, to worship him in a really pure form. This is the verse that the Lord laid on Lisa's heart. And as I read it, Ben, would you just come? Maybe you could come by yourself and we're going to close with a song and apply this. But if you hear this, hear it with your heart. 1 Peter chapter 6, 5, 6 through 11. It says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. It says, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, and he's looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that our brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. Verse 10 says, and the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. The promise for you. As I kind of bring things to a close, I want to leave you with two thoughts. One, if life's circumstances and situations are a discipline from the Lord, I challenge you and encourage you to embrace his discipline. Embrace it wholeheartedly. I mean, grab onto it. God, if you're disciplining me, I take it. And if he's disciplining you, you know it. If he's disciplining you, he's been challenging you on certain things, be it subtle little sins that you think are little, but they add up and become big, be it addictions, be it whatever, stuff hidden in the dark closet. The reason he exposes that stuff through his light, the reason that he allows discipline to come in is because he loves you. And so you know it if he's disciplining you. You know it if your life is falling apart because God is allowing it to fall apart because he's trying to get your attention. You know that. The challenge for you this morning, if that's the case, is for you to just come to a place of repentance and say, God, I come clean. I'm caught red-handed. Great thing about getting caught and coming honest and coming clean is that you find that you're so embraced and loved by God and that he can deal with the stuff, right? When we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive and cleanse from all unrighteousness. That's one side. If you feel like your life is fragmented and in pieces and your heart is broken, but you're not doing a thing wrong, that literally you've sat before him, you've knelt before him, you've cried out to God, God, show me what is it and I'll fix it. And you hear what I like to call the nothing. Just hearing static. What do you do? What do? Let me tell you what you do. You do what Elizabeth did. Just worship him. Just worship him and walk in peace knowing that something greater is happening. He's orchestrating something that he needs to orchestrate. And he who began a good work is faithful to complete it. And our God who does these things, it's declared about him that he does all things well. All things well. What is he looking for? What has he always been looking for? That they will be my people and I will be their God. You know what he wants you to be? His child. Just his child. Rest in him. Rest in him. Your situation and circumstance might not change as a result of this message. You might still have to go right back into whatever the broken, fragmented pieces are. But guess what can change as a result of this message? You. You can change. You can change. Because God is putting the pieces back together. Just as you see the stained glass, beautiful mosaic. You're a beautiful mosaic. And you might feel like a lump of glass. It doesn't make sense. He'll make sense of it. That's the gift of Jesus. John the Baptist heralded the message. Behold the Lamb of God. He takes away the sins of the world. He had a story to tell. I could tell you a story about my mom. She shouldn't have even had me. I could tell you a story about my dad. He got a big bad time out for doubting. But let me tell you the most important story of all. The Lamb of God, he's coming. He takes away the sins of the world. He's a redeemer. Let's stand together. And let's just take a moment. I don't know what song you're playing. I don't want to throw you off, but maybe we can sing that Come Let Us Adore Him Again. And let's also sing this. We gathered as a staff a couple nights ago, and we sang this together. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. That song takes on a new meaning in light of a message like this. That God, here I am showing up. And maybe you put yourself in the shoes or in the situation of a wise man or a shepherd or somebody who's come to the scene and said, just before Jesus, here I am to worship you. In the midst of my Elizabeth-like circumstances, here I am to worship you. In the midst of my victory, here I am to worship you. But one thing that will always remain constant and the same about me, God, I want to be blameless before you, and I want to be a worshiper of you. Let's just sing that together, and then we'll close. The light of the world to come and shine brightly into our hearts. We offer you our lives once again as living sacrifices given back to you. God, we thank you that you understand every tear that we cry and you record it, Lord. You keep it. It's precious to you. You know our hurts. You know our shame. You know our pain. And you are a redeemer of all those things. We don't understand the timing, but God, we trust you in it. So we offer pure praise to you here this morning. We hand over the timing to you. Hand over the results to you, and we take our proper posture, just like Zachariah's posture before your throne was flat on his face, trusting that he wouldn't be overwhelmed by your mighty power. God, we take our place before you, just flat on our face, saying, God, you are the master and we are your servants. And I thank you the perspective that we gain now because of Jesus is we are your children and you are our father. receive that through the gift of Jesus this morning. We love you, Father. Can we sing that? Here I am to worship.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. Altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. All together love me, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me.
Jesus. I really believe that the purest form of worship that we can offer is the sacrifice of praise. It's the praise that costs us something. And as you go throughout your week and as you go throughout this Christmas season, continue to offer the sacrifice of praise to God, surrendering the things that you don't understand, be it about your life or somebody else's, surrendering them back to God, and understand this, He's with you. He is with you. He is Emmanuel, God with us. He's not over here, over there, or up here. He's with you. And just as Zechariah was before the throne of God, offering incense and intercession for the people, this is where it gets really good. And this is where I hope that you hear this, that in your weakness, the Holy Spirit of God offers intercession for you. He's on your side. He's with you. And He's empowering you. So God, now will you bless them, God, each one, and keep them. Make your face shine upon them and give them peace. You're the Prince of Peace. So would you manifest your peace to them, God? We honor you, Lord. And we receive from you all that you want to give to us. And our reply and our response is, we love you, we honor you, and here, God, here is our sacrifice of praise. Thank you for these days. We love you, Jesus, in your precious name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.